It is my great pleasure to welcome you to tonight's screening of a compelling documentary, The American Nurse. We at Hunter are immensely proud of our nursing students and of our nursing school, whose national stature has grown under the leadership of its outstanding dean, Gail McCain. Gail, where are you? Thank you for all you do. It's also a pleasure to welcome Dean McCain's distinguished colleagues, clinical nursing professor Anita Nierenberg, the recipient of the Oncology Nursing Society's Lifetime Achievement Award, and Liz Capizzuti, the Hearst Foundation Chair of Gerontology. I'd also like to recognize members of Hunter's Nursing Advisory Board, Manuel Coe, Jr., Cynthia Skulko, Terry Straub, and our great friend from the Weill Cornell Medical College, Dr. Julianne Imperato McGinley. And finally, another loyal friend from Weill Cornell Medical College, Dr. Jeffrey Lawrence. The documentary you are about to see is a look at the real world of nursing, one that many of you here this evening know firsthand, from the physical strains to the emotional demands to the immense satisfaction of helping people in need. The fact that the film captures this reality so well is a credit to its makers, starting with director-producer Carolyn Jones and including one of Hunter's own, Barbara Glickstein, the co-director of our Center for Health, Media, and Policy. Following the film, please join us for a panel discussion with Barbara, Carolyn, and our Hunter colleagues, Jay Roman, Professor and Chair of Film and Media Studies, and Shyama Venkateswar, Director of the Public Policy Program here at Roosevelt House. Thank you, and enjoy the film.
Thank you for being here with me and with us this evening. To my left is Carolyn Jones, the award-winning filmmaker of The American Nurse. Next to her is Shyama Venkateswar, who is the director of the Public Policy Program here at Roosevelt House, and Jay Roman, who is the chair of the Department of Film and Media Studies at Hunter College. Please refer to your program and read their full biographies, which will inform you even further of their excellence and their incredible scholarship in the areas that we'll be framing tonight's discussion. And if you make art accessible and beautiful enough, people will want to follow where the thought goes. And because they're deciding where they want to go with it, they're more easily able to connect it to their own experience. Story-driven documentaries can change minds, attitudes, and policies. Thanks to Carolyn Jones, and joining us this evening in the audience is producer Lisa Frank and associate producer Candace Thompson. Thanks to the entire Jones production crew. Thanks to the entire Jones production crew and the five professional registered nurses, we finally have a 21st century real picture of the American nurse. Let's have a round of applause for this documentary. I'd also like to thank President Raab and Rebecca Connor. This program is co-sponsored by the President and Arts Across the Curriculum. I know that we have an incredible mixture of audience this evening, and I'm framing our discussion post-screening really looking at the role of art and its role in the university setting and across our communities. But you will have a chance to also speak, and you can direct your questions to any one of our panelists. So I'd like to start first with Carolyn Jones. Photographer and documentary filmmaker, The American Nurse Project, for those of you who don't know, is a book, a film, and a multimedia website with over 100 interviews with nurses from across the United States. The website has the name The American Nurse Project, so please go to it. It's listed also in the program. When this program was conceived this evening, it was conceived really for students and faculty, and of course we welcome you in the community. But the students get the first question. And first I'd like to ask all the students in the room to please raise your hand and identify yourself. Thank you for being here. Yeah, let's clap for them. I know that Carolyn got her first camera at age 13 when she got permission from her parents to turn in her violin for one.
Did I tell you that?
I read about it somewhere. I do my homework. Why a camera, Carolyn Jones? And then, if you will, take us on your abridged CJ tour on the road you traveled and drove through to developing and producing personal documentary narratives.
Oh my goodness, I didn't see that coming. Well, first of all, can I just say thank you for inviting us here this evening and letting us screen this film here. It's just a wonderful opportunity, and I thank my fellow panelists for being here. And Barbara Glickstein, who's been sort of tirelessly out there being a champion for this film. And a special thanks to Lisa and Candace, who are in the audience tonight, because films don't get made by one person, that's for sure. Well, I gravitated towards a camera when I was a kid because it was my way of communicating with people. It was my passport into other people's worlds. And that has been a gift. Knowing that has been a gift my whole life. And being able to be in the world of nurses has been the best world of all so far for 100 reasons, which I won't go into, but I'm not ready to leave it yet. I'll tell you that. It's been 4 years that I've been in your world, and we're up for another 2 anyway, I think, right, ladies?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We've started another project that involves nurses, so I'm very excited about that. And as far as my journey goes, you know, honestly, it's been probably the journey that led me here tonight started with a book I did in 1994 about people living with AIDS and HIV. And that was really what opened my eyes to wanting to tell stories about things that matter to people and find the humanity that I could zero in on and share with other people. I'm always looking for the best in people. And in nurses, I have found this unbelievably unique group of people that possess some talents and traits that I'm in awe of. So I have become kind of an official nurse groupie, and I think I'm going to probably keep holding that title for a little while longer.
Thank you. Shyama, many injustices are invisible to the mainstream. What does the film say about the world we live in?
I just want to say what a fantastic kind of entry point into so many social issues that our country faces. You know, I sat there and I was making notes of all the things that I think you so wonderfully and subtly and without really saying it, say it, which is the devastating impact of war. That is so, it so hugely comes out. And also the loneliness of the American people. I think that also comes out in this huge role that health professionals play and nurses play. I mean, there was this one sign which said, state maintenance ends here. And then it's all this rural roads and rural homes and people off the grid and off electricity and water and sanitation and all of that. And you showed that without making a statement about it. And I thought that was so clear about this tremendous inequality that our country has. So there are people who have access to healthcare in its most majestic ways that our country can provide, and there are those who do not have that. So I thought those were two huge statements that you made in the film.
Shyama, would you use those clips in one of your courses on public policy?
I would love to actually have you come and be a speaker in my classroom. Awesome. I think it would, and just if you could show just little collages of clips, if that you're able to do that
sure.
in some way, rather than a whole hour and 20 minutes, that we could sort of talk about it. It would be a conversation starter about where are the areas of kind of an eye-opening ways in which we need to let our students know and let larger audiences know and where are the areas of good and sensible and sound and profound public policy that needs to happen that is not mired in partisan debates?
Yeah, I just have to say, because that is one of my...
I knew that was...
That's like my favorite thing. Because out of all the people, I mean, I've been in this business for 30 years. I've been interviewing people, talking to people, meeting people from all walks of life. I've never met a group of people before that aren't mired in all kinds of politics and are able to look at things without judgment and to be able to deal with some of these issues, which is why nurses were the perfect lens to address these issues going on in America, because we can accept the information through the lens of a nurse. Mm-hmm. In a way that I don't think there is another way. So it is unique.
Jay Roman, Carolyn Jones chose show, don't tell, in the making of her documentary, The American Nurse. She managed to take us into the dark worlds of people incarcerated and into the homes of people dying who live in abject poverty in metal shacks in Appalachia. Yet it was highly entertaining. She didn't fall into preaching or hectoring or otherwise telling her audience what to think. Please address this issue of creating a judicious balance of art and message. And how does the American Nurse effectively do that?
Well, you know, historically, it's been done. A long-form documentary was a tradition on network television back in the late 50s and 60s. CBS Reports, NBC White Paper, ABC Close-Up. I was fortunate to know some of those people who worked on those documentaries. And then they weren't there anymore, okay? So those shows on television helped to establish a tradition, taking their audience into very steamy and undesirable situations. Just before I came here, I looked at a paper by a man named Burton Benjamin, who was a vice president at CBS and was a documentary maker. He was at the Gannett School on public policy. And he wrote a paper called The Documentary in Endangered Species. And he was lamenting the fact, the disappearance of documentaries from network television, and where were they going to be distributed? Today that's changed, right? Today we have lots of distribution areas for documentary, lots of distribution points. So I would say about Carolyn's documentary, and I would say something that relates to Don Hewitt, the creator of 60 Minutes, when he was asked the question, what do you do at 60 Minutes? And he said, we tell stories. Hmm. So what Carolyn and her team have done in this documentary, as Sharma said, this is not just a story about nurses. And that's where the good documentaries succeed. It's a story about lots of things, as Sharma mentioned. And that's where, you know, anyone can pick up a camera and say, oh, I think I'll make a documentary, especially an undergraduate student, right? But that's where we come in as teachers and as professionals. You know, we come in and we try to get them to understand. We show them work like yours, and try to get them to understand not only the art and the aesthetics of documentary, but getting that point, you know, getting that story across, and how do you do it? And you know, when I watch your documentary, someone who's watched a lot of documentaries, and when that nurse was driving all in Appalachia up that water, I was saying to myself, where is your camera person?
Tell him, Carol.
That's a story.
Well, I don't know. Yeah, you can. Tell him. He wants to know.
So, first of all, I've been kind of sweating bullets hoping that you liked the film. So I'm glad to hear that.
It's a great film.
This was a book before it was a film, and we had gone there to photograph Jason, and I'd photographed him in that creek with the house behind him, right? And you can only go up that creek if it hasn't been raining too much, and it used to be a driveway. But because of top of the mountain mining, it was flooded. So the guy that lived in the house back there was dying of black lung disease, and that was who Jason was going to try to help. So I had stared at this photograph that I had taken of Jason standing in that creek for like a year. I had made this big 6-foot by 6-foot print of it that was, we had made a show of a lot of the prints that were in the American nurse, and I had this one print that was in my living room forever because I had fallen in love with this photograph. But all this time I was wondering, you know, what's in that house? I was looking at that house for like a year. And so we said, okay, we're going back, we're getting in the car, we're going to shoot this film, or we're going to capture Jason, you know, driving up that creek. So we did, and Yaka, who's not here tonight, who you have to, you just, I don't know how to describe Yaka. He's fearless, and Lisa and I were kind of cowering in the back seat so that you couldn't see us, but Yaka said, drop me off here. Like, where? There wasn't, you know, but he got out into the water and climbed up. I mean, there are people, like, with shotguns coming out of their homes looking at us, but he climbs up, and he's able to get the shot of the car coming up the creek, right? So right after we shot, though, we were coming down the creek, and we ripped off the entire front fender of the car. Now, you saw, Jason is like a car mechanic, which was hugely helpful in this particular circumstance. But Yaka, like, jumps out of the car, and both of these guys with, like, their underwear showing from behind bend down, get in this water, which is freezing. Lisa and I are like standing off to the side like, you're kidding me. And they unscrew this fender as the sun is going down and the shotguns are coming out, and finally they remove the fender and we get in and we go back. But it was a day. It was remarkable.
I'm going to come back to you, Carolyn. In a hyper-mediated world, often the audience you care about is not the one in the room with you, but the one you'll reach through partnerships, mass, and social media. You describe your work as being socially proactive and that you create projects that point attention to global issues. Who's seeing the American nurse? What organizations have you partnered with that have woven the American nurse into their campaigns as a lever for change since its release last May?
Well, I'm gonna ask you to help because you're part of my social outreach, but you know, this project, I always wanted the public to really understand what nurses do, and it was hugely important to have nurses see it. So we started there, because I think that you hear about a movie called The American Nurse, and, you know, let's face it, people weren't breaking down the door to run to that film when Frozen was playing or whatever, I don't know, Fast and Furious 7 or whatever else is out there. It's not like, oh, yeah, let's go see The American Nurse. So I needed nurses first, and we went to the American Nurse Foundation that was a huge supporter of this project and helped us. I wanted all the proceeds from the book to go towards a scholarship fund to help make more nurses out there. So they organized that for us, and also a portion of the proceeds from the film go to that same scholarship fund. So they were the first to come on board. I'm going to draw a blank on all that, because everything's initials, and I can never remember
all
the initials.
Well, it's just important that there are professional nursing organizations. And in addition, I know that people are showing screenings. And in the theater lobbies, if it's a local issue around supporting aging housing in the community, people are doing that in the lobbies. And so the film is being used by nurses to talk about scope of practice, to talk about access to care, and other issues that are raised in the film, but the broader issues are also open and available to screenings throughout the country, which are still happening, and a pitch for May 6th, where the film is gonna be shown in over 200 theaters in the United States to honor what is traditionally called Nurses Day and Nurses Week. Little plug there for the film.
But you know, I do wanna say too, it was always meant to be a tool. So I hope nurses will use it. I wanted it to be used that way, the way you want to use clips in your classroom and to sort of dissect it and look at some of the different, you know, we've talked about all kinds of things. Barbara helped us write kind of a guide so that we could look at the moments in the film that were dramatic and could be explored a little bit more deeply, like Sister Stephen deciding not to give her father antibiotics. That's a really that opens up a really interesting conversation. So we have these talking points in the film that we're really interested in people exploring and using it as a tool as much as possible.
Before we open up to you, I have one other question for Shyama. In March, JAMA published a report from data on more than almost 300,000 registered nurses that analyzed data from the National Sample Survey of Registered Nurses, which ended in 2008, as well as from the Census Bureau's American Community Survey from 2001 to 2013. Here's the result. About 90% of nurses are women, we knew that, and they make about $11,000 less per year than nurses who are men. Only half the pay gap between male and female nurses can be explained by things like education and experience. Shyama does a lot of research around women's equity issues across the globe. So my question to you is a male nurse worth $5,148 more than a female nurse? And what are the gender gap issues on pay equity in the United States that could be addressed in this film?
Such a great question. I mean, when you think about the fact there's actually a nursing shortage in this country, right? We know that. And in fact, there's some, right back at you, some Bureau of Labor Statistics data which says that, you know, by 2020, registered nurses will grow by 36%, and there'll be a shortage of over quarter of a million of nurses by 2025, right? So we start looking at data about where the nursing profession is headed, and we know very well that health professionals is the fastest growing field since 2008. I mean, there's clear indication that the health profession is a growth industry. Nursing and all the kind of medical practices around the healthcare industry will grow. So now let's look at the pay equity issue, right? So as you all know, pay equity continues to be a profound problem in the American economy. There's not a single occupation out there that women actually don't make more than men. I think the number went up by 1% this past year. It's 77 cents to a dollar. But still, when you break that down by race, black women, Latina women make less than white women on an average. So I think just like any other profession, we need to be paying attention to pay equity, paycheck fairness, looking at how we can actually raise minimum wage issues across the board. I mean, I think nursing is just one more example where there is no pay equity justice, and we are once more reminded about how stark that difference is when you raise that difference about $5,000. It is such as a profession, kind of a, you know, bottom up. I mean, they're involved in every aspect of somebody's life from birth, and we saw that, from birth to end of care, end of life, and caregiving and hospice facilities there. So to my mind, it boggles me that there would be such a discrepancy. Now, there is a role for unions, and this is where I think associations and unions and, you know, labor unions can play a very big role, not just for nurses, but certainly for all women. Certainly there needs to be an increase in minimum wage issues. There has to be an increase in livable wage issues. And a look at where we are on pay gaps between men and women. That is a public policy issue.
Thank you.
I'd just like to add something.
Yes.
I'm not going to debate what you just said because it's true. But I do want to say that Carolyn's documentary really, I think, kind of demonstrated, because you know what, when I grew up, nurses were all women, and it was very balanced, and you had the men in the picture as well. And I think when it's distributed to a wide audience, that's a very important point to make, and that men can be nurses as well. Mm-hmm. And as you know, the fellow from Appalachia said, he was a truck driver. But man, truck driving wasn't for him. He didn't fit in, and he became a nurse. And this was a macho guy that rode a motorcycle, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that's a very good statement to make for the wider audience.
Thank you. Now, who has the audience mic? Thank you. I'm going to insist that people make their statements or questions brief. So thank you. If you have a question or a statement you'd like to make, please raise your hand and we'll get you a mic. There's a hand raised up here. Remember, brevity is beautiful.
How did you come to choose these five nurses for the movie?
We interviewed over 100 nurses, and you can find them all on the website, which we're really proud of, at American Nurse Project. They touch on all kinds of topics. But so Lisa will attest to this, too. As we traveled across the country, there are certain people as a filmmaker that you really connect to, first of all. So there were people that I felt I had a certain ability to communicate. But it was topic-driven. Kind of addressing the returning war veterans for me was a very, very important thing that I wanted to dig into. Poverty was without a doubt something I wanted to explore. I think we're uncomfortable as Americans talking about poverty in our own backyard, and I wanted to drive home the point that it's there. The prison system I went to because I was constantly amazed at the ability to care for others without judgment. And I thought, well, let's just throw ourselves in the largest state penitentiary in the country, the largest maximum security state penitentiary. So that's why we went there. And then Sister Stephen was a complete no-brainer. I mean, what are you going to not do her, right? I mean,
we'll have forms in the back if you'd like to join that nursing home in your older years.
That took like 2 seconds, so I couldn't not go there. I saw the beginning of life. We were there, and like within 30 minutes, a goat was born. We captured that. You didn't get to see that because it's just really gross, but we thought about putting it in, and I think it might be an extra on the DVD. I don't even know if we showed it all then. It's funky. But anyway, so to see the beginning of life and see the end of life, the whole cycle there was just amazing. And then Naomi Cross, you know, we talked a lot about it. I thought that I was choosing nurses from such diverse backgrounds that we were kind of nervous that the public wouldn't really be able to understand this kind of nursing because it's not the way we see the profession as laymen. So everybody can relate to a baby being born, and then we had this unbelievably rich story of this woman with ovarian cancer who for some unknown reason was allowed us the privilege to come in and photograph the birth of her child. So beginning of life, end of life, poverty, returning war veterans, and this ability to be non-judgmental. Those were the things I was focused on.
Do it.
Thank you so much for this film and for sharing it with us today. I was wondering if anyone's using it to advocate for compassionate release for prisoners who are at the end of life.
Well, why don't you tell everyone what work you do?
I work with criminal justice-involved families, and have previously worked in the jail setting, but with juveniles, much, much different population, but anyway.
She's a professor of nursing in the school, at our school.
Oh, I love that. Well, you know, I think not. Lisa's saying no, that is definitely not happening.
What's not happening?
The answer to your question, no one is currently using it to
But we're happy to help you do that.
Yeah. In any way we can.
Yeah, and I know some people doing that work would love to connect it to them if they haven't seen it.
Oh, fantastic. And I mean, you know, I really like this kind of slice and dice approach to this film, like take the part that's meaningful to the community that you want to talk to and use it to really expose a topic. And I think that's a great one. So thanks.
Yeah. Just for me, Lafayette became a nurse.
Oh,
and their moment that he's bathing John and putting cream on his feet is the most biblical imagery. And I think about him. I carry him. I remember that he's someone who's really being, it's all about redemption and whatever that means for you. For me, it was just an incredible moment. And I carry that moment with me in the film. I never get tired of seeing it.
And he's not a nurse. So like me, like the rest of us, I got to learn that, you know, caring for someone so intimately is remarkably healing. And that work that he does every day, that's healed him.
We have another question up front. Wait, Dr. Nikitas, please wait for that mic.
Thank you. You clearly captured the profound work that nurses do, and there's many of us in the audience, and we celebrate that work. As a veteran, I was on that bus. Oh. I was on that plane.
Wow.
Profound memories just come back for all of us, and I thank you for that. Mm. But for the students in the audience, what's the public policy message that they need to take away tonight? We touch families and communities in very intimate ways, but as nurses, with our voices, we must educate and inform stakeholders of healthcare and policymakers. What would you tell us?
So here's the deal. Nobody knows what nurses do. They don't know how well educated you are. You don't talk about what you do. You heard Jason in the film, and Jason was saying, you know, people are like, woo-hoo-hoo, I don't want to know too much about what you do, right? So, and the thing is, our country is missing the boat because we've got this incredible treasure chest of nurses that holistically understand what would make us function better as a country. So we need to hear from nurses. We need to hear their voices. I mean, that's what this whole project has been about, is to try to be more verbal, be out there more. People do need to hear what you do. I think it becomes this kind of insulated environment. And I urge you to, as new nurses, to not let that happen. People do want to know what you're doing, and I think the noisier you are, the better.
Barbara, if I could take a crack at that question as well. The takeaway that I had was the clear need for more decentralized medical care, community level, you know, medical facilities available in rural communities, in poor communities, so to move away from this high medicalized environments that the tendency is now growing towards, you know, these big medical conglomerates that exist. I mean, you forget the caregiving aspect at the end of it. And so what I saw, I think that your message was so strong, that we need more community level medical personnel on the ground because they are really the front lines of caregiving.
Well, and the future of it, I think, right? Isn't home health care where it's at? A little side note, Jason actually went, is he now a nurse practitioner?
Yeah, he's 6 months away. Yeah.
Okay, so, and he was working in a hospital, and he worked in a hospital for about, I want to say a year for his clinicals, and he's decided to go back to home health. Yeah. So, you know, it is an unbelievably rewarding side of things, and I think there's a lot of autonomy in that realm, too. So you're right to point that out.
We have time for one more short question. Okay, thank you.
Are you able to tell us what the project for the next 2 years is about?
Oh, I love that you asked that.
And thank you. And thank you for this brilliant film.
Was that a plant,
it was
really?
A plant. Oh, thank you. That was perfect. On cue.
No, I don't think it was.
It was on cue.
So after 4 years of talking to nurses, being with nurses, photographing them, interviewing them, we landed on one thing. And that's the main thing that I walked away with, is that we don't know how to die very well. And we don't do it well. Oh, good. I'm happy to have your support on this.
It's not so popular at cocktail parties.
No, my husband's like, could you don't tell him what you're working on.
Oh, no, it's that topic.
But not only can the country not sustain where all of our dollars go for the last two years of life, but none of us are very happy about the way we're doing it. And I think nurses are in a really unique position to be able to guide us in a better way. And so we are, with the same group of unbelievable women I get to work with, we're working on a new project called Dying in America. And which of course you recognize the title from the IOM report. And we, right now we're building a website and interviewing 50 nurses. Unfortunately, one was just here that was in our, well, we represented Calvary already with some of the nurses that we've talked to about end of life. And we're going to show them on the website doing storytelling, talking about their own personal experiences, what they know about end of life that we don't know. And then through those 50 nurses that we meet and put on the website, we'll choose 1 to 3 and shoot another documentary film and explore and hopefully be subtle about the topics that we're really trying to grasp and tell the story of dying in America.
I just wanted to announce, because it's new news and very important news, that in addition to several outstanding awards that the American Nurse has received, including the Johnson & Johnson Media Award for Excellence, the American Nurse film and its director, Carolyn Jones, have been invited to participate as cultural envoys in the 2015 American Film Showcase, a major film diplomacy program of the U.S. Department of State managed by USC School of Cinematic Arts. This film will be represented in that extraordinary program and shown globally. So let's congratulate the team. Just in closing, I want to say that the right balance of art and message can really both move hearts and minds. Striking this balance, however, can be difficult. You know you've struck gold when you're able to say something so clearly that it hardly needs to be said at all, but is instead embodied in the way you say it. The American Nurse is an important contribution to America's ongoing conversation about what it means to care. Thank you, Carolyn Jones, Shyama Venkateswar, Jay Roman, President Raab, Rebecca Connor, from Arts Across the Curriculum, for this evening of art and conversation. Have a pleasant evening.